So I don't want to take too long. I want to kind of jump right in this so we can get us out at a decent time. Hopefully they don't run out of food at the buffet. But I feel like if they do, it's probably the Lord doing me a favor, just helping me out a little bit. No, son, you need to fast. Praise God. Okay. So, but we've been in this series, Who Do You Think You Are? We've been talking about identity. We've been working through the book of Ephesians, verse by verse, which the book of Ephesians is all about identity. Paul writes a letter to the church in Ephesus and really for the church of Asia Minor as a whole, which is predominantly a Gentile church, reinforcing who Christ is, the simple gospel, what has Christ done, who he is, and that he is indeed God, and who we are in Christ, and how we should behave in accordance with that, and what that should look like in our lives. So in this day and age, and where we're at right now, I know everybody's really excited. We get closer and closer every week to Election Day. We're all stoked about that, and I'm sure we're stoked about sitting down to family dinner soon, and Thanksgiving, it'll be here before you know it, and bringing up politics. I mean, you like to do that at the family dinner table. I know that's a good time. So anyway, in this season, where so many things are pulling at us to find our identity, and we have to find our identity in Christ. And this is so important. So we've been on this series now. I encourage you, if this is your first week, go check out the series. We've been kind of laying a lot of groundwork as we go through the context of this letter, what was going on, all of that, so you can catch all these things. But we are at the second half of chapter 4, and we're kind of trucking along here. And in this little part I've lovingly given the title, Tell the Truth, Shame the Devil. Tell the truth, shame the devil. We're going to talk about how we like to lie. Oh, yeah, good. This already feels great. So the second half of chapter 4, Paul begins to focus on expected behavior patterns from one who has truly received Jesus. Paul begins to lay out like, hey, it's great now that you've encountered Christ, and it's great that he's made you alive, and these are the things that you can expect to begin to flow out of your life. It's not really optional, y'all. It's not like, well, some of us will get it, and some of us, you can just live how you want, and you're going to be good too. No. This begins to happen in our life as we get transformed by the Holy Spirit. It should show up in our behaviors. Right? Isn't that wild, right? So he describes what it looks like to lead a Spirit-led life, and he starts in a familiar place, and if you have read any of Paul's writings, you know he likes to talk about this, and that's the mind. That the mind must be renewed. In fact, the mind needs to be renewed daily. How do I renew my mind, Pastor? Well, first of all, you pray. You spend time with the Lord. Guess what? Here's a good one. You read your Bible. Every day. Every day. Every day. Read your Bible. Why? It's transforming your mind, right? You know what else you can do? You can get in Christ-centered community. And together, we have the mind of Christ, so we can come and reason together and explore the Lord together and grow in him, reinforcing who we are in Christ so we can stand firm even in the midst of pressure to compromise. So let's start in Ephesians 4, 17. We're going to just keep cruising through Ephesians. It says, now this I say, and I testify. Somebody better testify, right? I mean, I love it. JD, you were getting me excited, man. You got that preacher voice. You started, hey, somebody want to testify? Come on now. Until you start saying the food was going to run out of the buffet. That's when I was like, devil is a lie. I don't receive that. And so I say, and testify in the Lord that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do. Hold up. Isn't he writing to a Gentile church? But yet he's no longer referencing them as Gentiles. Why? Because they now belong in the kingdom of God. No, we don't identify you as that anymore, because you belong in the kingdom, right? So he says, you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance. Catch that. The ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. Does that sound familiar? Right? This isn't new, y'all. It's just another season, right? This is not, I believe as Solomon said, there's nothing new under the sun. After Jesus, we move counterculture. Hear me this. If you encounter Jesus and you surrender your life to Jesus, you should be different. We now are different. You understand what holiness is? It isn't that you're perfect. It's that you're set apart. You've been made different by Jesus. So your life should look different. Now it's a process. It's not overnight, but steadily you're going through what's called sanctification. That means steadily things are falling off of you. Old addictions are dying, right? Old ways of thinking are leaving as you're becoming more like Christ. This is to be expected. We should move counter to culture. Notice Paul immediately points to the issue of their mind, which then leads to the issue of a calloused heart. You've heard people say, guard your heart, right? Go, guard your heart, brother. Brother, guard your heart, right? Well, you cannot guard your heart without guarding your mind. It starts in your thought life, right? You guard your mind. You have your mind renewed. So he's not bashing the lost. He's pointing out simply that they don't know any better. Remember that word ignorance? They're ignorant. They just don't know. He's not saying they're so stupid. Watch out for those dumb Gentiles out there. No. They don't know. And if their hearts are darkened, what are we supposed to do? Well, we're supposed to bring the light. We're supposed to light it up for them. To bring a light into the darkness, to bring the truth, to bring the hope, so they don't have to stay in that state any longer. They can be set free. This is what he's pointing us to. So he's talking about the futility of their minds, or the futile. So in the Greek, literally in the English, it just means useless or pointless, right? It's so the carnal mind is what? Ultimately, it's useless and it's pointless. There is no point. There is no eternal end to the carnal mind. It leads you nowhere, right? This in front of us, everything is temporary. That's why when you're walking with Jesus, right, you're now focused on eternity. You're focused on doing things that matter for eternity because you recognize this is just a short little stop in your life, right? But if not, if you're in the carnal mind, it is useless and pointless. In the Greek, the word there for that little kind of phrase, it breaks down to this. One, what is devoid of truth. So what is the carnal mind? It's devoid of truth. Man, they wouldn't know the truth if it smacked them in the face, right? It's devoid of truth. And here's a good word, appropriateness. Doesn't know. Now, some of you are like, yeah, I can relate to that. I don't know if I've ever been appropriate in my life. You know, right? Devoid of truth and appropriateness. It's perverseness and depravity. And then here's an interesting one. This is kind of the last word I had breaking this down. Frailty. The carnal mind is frail. What it's easy to break. It breaks under pressure. I wonder if we look around today how many mental breakdowns we're seeing everywhere. Right? And look here, I'm not going to lie to you. If I didn't have Jesus in this world, sign me up. Like, my mind's gone. It's gone. It's been broken. Why? Because the carnal mind is fragile. Whereas a mind that has been renewed, as someone who is rooted in Christ, man, you can see it and take it and be all right. You can move from trial and testing and from situation to situation and say, I am not going to break because it is not me that's holding me together. It's him. Like, I don't have to bow down this. I don't have to give in. See, truth is expendable to the carnal mind. Truth is something we can throw out the window if there's something better that comes along. It doesn't ultimately matter if it advances what we perceive as to be the greater good. So we throw it out. So truth to the carnal mind is expendable. They are greedy to practice every kind of impurity. This isn't just like, hey, I made some mistakes. Or every once in a while, you know, oh man, I kind of went astray here. You know, this is, the language reads, they're greedy to practice impurity. They want more. How much further can we push this away from God? This is the mindset. And you'd have to have been living under a rock if you haven't seen this in culture today. That we're pushing the boundaries as far as we can to get away from God, to get away from his word. I control my life. Nobody controls. I control my, right? It's pushing further and further away. This is the carnal nature on full display. It goes counter to God's word. They have given themselves up to whatever feels good, to whatever feels right for them, to what makes them happy, regardless of how God may view it or how it may impact those around them. Hear me on this. This might be a little controversial, but one of the most toxic things you could tell somebody, giving somebody advice is, oh, sweetheart, just do what makes you happy. No. Do what makes you holy. Something that makes you happy now ultimately may not be good for you. In fact, ultimately, it may be leading you straight to hell. But it makes me happy right now. Ooh, yeah, this is good. This is, let that simmer for a second. Say, well, Pastor, this is what I want. This is my desire. Oh, okay. Does it line up with the Word of God? No. Well, then get rid of it. Why? Because I want to be what makes me holy, what makes me separate. Not that I'm better than anybody else, but I want to be in line with the Lord. I want to follow Jesus. I don't want to follow the way of this world. So maybe something makes me happy. Well, then it's an indicator it shouldn't make me happy. I got a heart issue. I got a mind issue, and I need to be renewed. Something needs to be crucified to the cross of Christ. It needs to die. They've given themselves up to whatever it is that may make them happy. Ephesians 4, 20 through 24, continuing right along. It says, but that, oh, I love this, but that is not the way you learned Christ. So he's like, all this stuff I just told you, that is not the way. That's not what you learned in Christ. And then he goes on to say, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus. The truth is in Jesus. And what is this truth? Here's the truth in 4:22. It's Jesus, but as expressed out, it says, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through, catch this, deceitful desires. Well, listen, I hear this all the time. Well, I prayed and the desire is just still there. Of course it is. It's deceitful. And it wants to trick you. Some of the worst advice you could ever hear is to follow your heart. Do not follow your heart. It's wicked and it's corrupt. It needs Jesus. Follow the Word of God. Follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, right? Have your mind renewed to line up with His Word, right? So we look at this, deceitful desires. And to be renewed, then he goes on to say this in 23. It says, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds and to put on, I love this language, to put on the new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. It's tough living in a society that exalts things that go completely against what Christ teaches. There is constant pressure to compromise, which is why we must be in prayer, which is why we must be in the Word, which is why we must be in Christ-centered community. Don't fool yourself in thinking, oh, no, I got it. No, you don't. Listen, the devil uses the same tricks, and there's a reason why. He's really good at them. He's tricked us many times. He's deceived us many times, especially when your carnal nature wants to go towards that. This is why we need accountability. This is why daily we must be in prayer. Daily we must be in the Word. To be in Jesus is to put off the old and put on the new. Hear me, there will be change. You will change in Christ. There will be change. I mean, things will take, man, I started this in the first service and it was great. It just made the room really uncomfortable, so I'm going to do it again because I really enjoyed it. But some of you remember Obama, remember President Obama? Yeah, and I said, now you already, the room is already just split of just like, there's different opinions already going on out here, right? But remember, he said something that got really popular and it was, yes, we can, right? So what I'm here to tell you is, yes, you can change. You can change. No more excuses. No more, well, you don't know how my father is like. Cool, that's awesome. You got a Father in heaven that says, I have a new identity for you. I have a new place for you. I have a new path for you. You don't have to end up like them. You don't have to go to prison. You don't have to be chained to the addiction anymore. You don't have to stay depressed, wake up depressed, go to bed depressed. But you can be a new life alive today. You can change. Not only can you change, it's expected. Something over. There will be change. While the old man has been dealt a serious blow, when you get saved, the old man gets hit. That dead man gets crucified, right? He gets put down. But you know what he wants to do? He wants to resurrect in your life. He wants to come back. See, when we receive Christ, we enter into a process called sanctification, where daily we put the old man to death and step more and more into the new. Why? Because the dead man wants to resurrect. He wants to come back. We've experienced this. This is why the main meaning of the word repent in the Greek, it's metanoia. It's to change your mind. When you repent, what you're literally doing, you're just saying, God, I have wrong thinking on this situation. Change my mind. I don't want to think like this anymore. I can't think like this anymore. Renew my mind. I repent. I just have something to say, you know, because this has gotten really popular recently in just kind of the church world, and maybe you've seen a lot of it. And deliverance is important. I believe deliverance is necessary. And there's plenty of people that walk around, yes, that have literally been possessed by demons and they need deliverance. But the majority of the time, it's a stronghold in your thinking. It's not even the devil. It's you. The issue is between your ears. right? And you need, you got a stronghold, and you're thinking, what is a stronghold? Well, it keeps things in and it keeps things out. It's a powerful filter that everything you see, it passes through that filter. That's why your mind has to be renewed. That's why I say people come to a deliverance service over and over again. Same people over and over again, throwing up a trash can, screaming, rolling on the floor, and live the same life. It's a stronghold in their thinking. They need to have their mind renewed. Your dead man is showing. This man, there was back like when I was growing up, I'll date myself a little bit, back in the 90s, you know, early 90s, baby. Back in the 1900s when I was born, there was this saying got popular. I don't even know how it got popular. It was so stupid, but it literally became a thing for a little bit. And it was people, you go up to people and you say, hey, your epidermis is showing. It was like the weirdest thing because it was like the nerds just turned it on everybody. They're like, oh, you're an idiot. So now I'm going to make fun of you, right? and you'd be like, oh, what? Oh, and so you're like freaking out and they're like, ah, it's your skin, dummy. Epidermis, right? So now I'm trying a new saying. It's your dead man is showing. We begin to tell people, oh, wait a minute. I recognize that because I knew you before Christ, and I see you coming back out right now. Right? You ever experienced that? You get cut off in traffic, and it's like that dead man's just ready to, oh, right back up. Let me help somebody. Let me just tell them the truth. No! Get back on that cross! But you be coming out right now. Right? We get it, and it's a process. This thing, sometimes it comes back, and we have to. We repent. Say, no. That's not who I am anymore. Get out of here. You're the dead man. So your dead man is showing. God loves the mind. It's our mind. I think about this. From all of the creation. Guys, I don't know if you've seen other creatures that exist on this planet. But like sometimes I wonder, like, how are we still here? Like, how haven't we just been eaten up? Right? What? Mind. Because we can figure things out. The mind is a brilliant creation. Right? This being created in the image of God separates us from everything. But so is this mind. And the way it works. So God created the mind. He loves the mind. It separates us from all other creation. This is why God doesn't throw away the mind. He renews it. He uses it. He puts it. He wants it back in the place where he meant it to be. He doesn't want to waste it. I mean, you've heard this. The mind is a beautiful thing. Don't waste it. God doesn't waste it. So why? Why is your thought life so important? Proverbs 23:7 tells us, as a man thinks, so he is or so he goes. Everything you've done, for the most part, usually, I don't know, guys, sometimes we can get away with this because we can literally think about nothing, and that's nice, but most everything you've done started with a thought. Started with a thought. You know, you don't have to give all thoughts access to land. Because sometimes, let's be real, y'all, let's be real. Like, Jesus addressed this. He said, you say, oh, if I commit adultery with a woman, you know, I've committed sin. And he said, if you look at a woman lustfully, you've already committed that sin. Why? Because that thought is already there, and you've let it land. Right? And so, we don't have to let every thought land. We might have the desire to get in our flesh and say something to somebody, right? Or use some of those words we used to say. Like, we can still access that vocabulary. We still know how that works, right? But instead, we say, nope, it can't land. It's not a sin that you have this thought try to come into your head. It's a sin when you partner with it and you walk it out. So don't give it access. Don't let it land, that we guard our minds. Our society, even the current church in America, has become so lazy about searching for truth in Scripture. As long as I feel good. I've literally had people say, oh, I love going to church. I feel good for the rest of the week until the next week. Man. Like, we don't want to search for truth. I have people text me all the time. You know what's so easy? I don't even know where it's at. Oh, here it is. What's incredible is you got a little portable seminary on your phone. I don't know if you knew this. There are so many apps now that you can literally open the Bible, click on words, find a concordance, and we'll tell you what it means in the Greek, what it means in the Hebrew. We have no excuse. The truth is at your fingertips. But yet that carnal nature wants to push you to, no, don't look for that. It's fine. You're good. Don't worry. Right. Whereas the Spirit of God wants to lead us into what? All truth. Not just to take things that are told to us, but rather search it out for ourselves to discover it for ourselves. We just want to feel good and have others do the work for us. See, tell the truth, shame the devil. There's a reason for that, because when you tell the truth, you're literally stopping the work of the enemy in your life. Why? Because he is the father of lies. I realized something. Lies are actually the language of insecurity. Lies are the language of insecurity. See, I really learned this when we started fostering our wonderful son, right? And we got trained about fostering kids and stuff, especially kids that have been in the system for a long time. And one of the things they told us is like, it's like a defense mechanism. They're just going to lie to you. They just know. They're going to lie to your face all the time. They're just going to lie. Why? Because it's a defense mechanism. Why? They don't feel safe. They don't feel safe. So early on, which, you know, Michael, I'm going to pick on him now. Picking on you, sorry. Early on, Michael would lie to me straight to my face. I knew he was lying. And one of the things is he's a terrible liar. You literally just have to ask him twice. He can't do it the second time. His face just breaks and you know, okay, you're lying, right? But in that case, let me tell you how I would respond. He would lie to me. And now hear me. I don't like when people lie to me. I'm not a fan. I don't know if you enjoy it. I don't know if you enjoy being lied to your face. I mean, some of you might do because you keep watching mainstream media. But you like people lying to your face. Right? Like, I don't like it. I don't like it. So what happens here, right, is he tells me this, and I don't respond with, you're a liar. Go to your room. No, it's a simple response of, hey, man, not a big fan of lying, but I look forward to when you trust me enough to tell me the truth. It doesn't mean what he did was okay. He knows that. But also, I recognize the fact that he doesn't quite feel safe enough yet to tell the truth without maybe thinking this is all going to be ripped from me. See, parents, listen to me. You need to create an environment that's safe for your kids to tell the truth. Now, that doesn't mean that there's not discipline, but real discipline is rooted in love. God teaches us how to discipline our children by how he disciplines and deals with us. He wants to find the root. God doesn't punish, right? Punishment is final. There is a day of punishment and day of judgment. God disciplines, which means he gets to the root of it and he deals with it. Why? So you can grow from it and stop dealing with it personally in yourself, in your own life. So here's what we got to do is we create a place where you can tell the truth, a place where people feel they can walk to the altar and be vulnerable because they know they're going to be met with love and not with shame. Why? But that's the thing is when you tell the truth, you what? Shame the devil. Lies lead you to more shame. Tell the truth, shame the devil. Lies empower the work of the enemy in your life, whereas the truth exposes it. Lies lead us to a place of shame. That's why when we tell the truth, we literally shame the devil. Ephesians 4, 25 through 27. It says, therefore, having put away falsehood. I like that. I like how it says that. Put away. What does it mean? I'm no longer entertaining lies. I've put that away. I don't entertain it anymore. Let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. How many of you love that verse? How many of you heard that in a marriage class? Don't let the sun go down on your anger, right? Wait, so, but why, though? Why is it telling us this? It says, why? Because of this right here. And give no opportunity to the devil. Why? Because your anger, if not dealt with, if not brought and processed with the Lord and with people you trust, right? What happens? It gives a foothold to the devil. You know, if somebody were to break into your house and they were trying to get in and you were trying to close the door, if they got their foot past the threshold of your home, that's all they need because now they have a foothold. They can break that door open and then take whatever they want. This is what happens when you don't deal with your anger. The enemy gets a foothold and he's coming in to wreck your life. I've always heard it said anger is the only emotion that literally destroys the vessel that carries it. We have to deal with it. Anger's not bad, right? Just said it's not a sin to feel anger, right? And it'll teach us a lot about ourselves, but we have to process it with the Lord. We have to take it and say, God, why am I so angry? That's one of the questions the Holy Spirit loves to ask me personally all the time. Why does that make you mad? And then I get mad that he asked me. Because I know why it makes me mad, because there's something that needs to die in me. And I'm not ready to let it go because it's a comfort. Man, I'm being really vulnerable with y'all. My goodness. Right? This is what we deal with. God is the author of truth. He desires, his spirit desires to lead us into all truth. Paul tells us to put away what is false. Put it away. This is not only to put away the lying and what is false in our own words and actions, but to stop entertaining lies. Listen, we live in a culture today that is okay with lies as long as it aligns with their perception of what the greater good is or their personal echo chamber. It doesn't matter if you're lying because that's justified because the other side is so bad. So we're cool with lying. Okay. Let's think about it like this. I'm going to go here. Why not? Just going to blow this wide open. Let's think about it. As we know, or if you don't know, then it's time to wake up. Most of the mainstream media will lie. They'll lie to you. That used to not be the case, but it's the case now. It's the case. They just lie to you. But here's the thing, is they've basically figured out the lies that one half of the country wants to hear and the lies the other half of the country wants to hear. So they've just taken sides, and we're still watching it and entertaining lies. Knowing they're lying to our face probably, but it's my team. No, it's not. If they're lying, they're not your team. Why? Because your team is about truth. It's about knowing the truth. It's about sharing the truth. That's why I say turn it off. Turn it off. And not only that, there's plenty of, I think one of the ones I really like a lot, I think it's called The Pour Over. That's what I subscribe to. And it's Christian news. And it's just straight up the events that happen. And it gives you a scripture to encourage you. Blessed. Amen. Well, thank you, Lord, for that. It'll really say inflation is out of control. But here's a scripture to remind you that God's your provider. Hallelujah. All right, I got a better day going on. Now, hear me. That doesn't mean we're supposed to be ignorant. But we are to search out the truth. That is possible. To not just means you're lazy. Search out the truth. See, lying is not the agenda of heaven. If it's not the agenda of heaven, whose agenda is it? It's hell's. The devil is the father of lies. He wants you to get you speaking his language. Lie, lie, lie. It's not the language of heaven. Speak and share the truth. Social media, the way information is shared today, we've seen this like, I see this post a lot now, and it makes me kind of giggle because I'm like, oh, man, what would the letter say? But it's like, if Paul were still around, the church in America would be getting a letter. I kind of disagree. I don't think it'd be a letter. I think it'd be a post. And I think he would tag everybody and say, hey, read this. Why? Because this is the way information is shared today. What does that mean? It matters what you post. It matters what you share. I'm not telling you to share something that's not the truth that may rile somebody up. That's fine. Right? I personally live by the thing, is this going to bring somebody closer to God? If not, I don't post it. Because I just personally don't see that. But we might have different convictions on that, and that's okay. But that we would be truthful in what we share. That we would be slow to type and quick to read. Right? Because that's what we live in now. That's how we share information, which means we're required to share the truth. And if we realize we haven't shared the truth, we come out and we repent for it, and then we share the truth. I don't know how this has gotten lost so much in our society other than the fact that that's where our carnal mind wants to go, and this is what the enemy wants, but that we be a people that are about the truth. That's what, even if it's uncomfortable, even if you don't want to hear it, that's the point, is we're about truth. Why? Because we follow the one who is truth. How can we follow the one that is truth but be okay with entertaining lies? It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't work that way. We need to be slow to speak and quick to listen. Learn quickly from your anger. As I said, don't allow it to stay long. This is such an important principle in all areas of our lives and relationships. Ephesians 4, 28 through 29. Keep going. It says, let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor doing honest work with his own hands. Praise God. Get a job. So that he may have something. Why should we work? Why should we work? So we might have something to share with anyone in need. Why do I want resource? So I can spread the kingdom of God with my generosity. This is why. I'm not trying to build something lavish for myself, not saying nice things are bad or you shouldn't have a nice home. That's totally cool. The Bible is totally cool with private property. It's fine. But the ultimate goal is that I can spread the kingdom of God because I want to be about eternity. So whatever that looks like, that I can share with anyone in need. Then he goes on to say this, let no corrupting talk come out your mouths. Do you all want to stop right now and just repent? Would that be a good time? Let's all, Lord help, forgive us. Okay, only such as is good for building up as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. It may give grace to those who hear. The Bible makes it clear that we are not to steal or even covet. This is what I tell you, the Bible is not against private property. It's not against people having something that's theirs, that they worked for. In fact, it's the opposite. It tells you, don't even think about stealing it. Don't even covet it. Right? Because that's not who you are. That's not who we are as a people. So the Bible is clear that to covet someone else or want to steal rather than work and make an honest wage so that ultimately, why? So we can have generosity. that we would work and be honest in what we do. Can I tell you? Because many of you don't have the privilege like I do to actually work for the church, right? So as you would expect, there's honesty and transparency all over the place. There's accountability, right? Like there's stuff, there's multiple layers of accountability here. And I love that. It's like a warm blanket. It helps me sleep at night, right? So, but on our jobs that we work, maybe in the secular world, as you would call it, right? Maybe at times you get offers to cut corners. You get offers to maybe lie just a little bit so you can make a little more money on that commission. Don't kid yourself and think that God looks at you and go, oh, that's cool. It's a lost secular world anyway. I mean, go ahead and make that money, sweetheart. No, that's not what he's saying. He expects you to represent him in that workplace. He expects you to even put your job at risk for your integrity and your morality. To say, no, I won't go along with this. No, I'm not going to mess somebody over with that. No, I'm not going to take advantage of somebody else's suffering to make some money. I refuse. Why? Because this is not the life Jesus has for me. I'm called to be truthful. I'm called to be honest. I'm called to live holy, set apart. I want to represent. Now listen, this would be helpful. Like I believe, like if we had more people really coming in with that attitude that, hey, I'm working for the glory of God, even if it's like a job just to get you in another job, right? Let's say it's McDonald's, right? Maybe that McDonald's, now the shake machine always works, right? Because you're there and you're honest and like you're giving people shakes, right? Amen, hallelujah. Like we stop lying about it. Well, it's broken. No, it's not. You're lying to me, right? So we take it up higher. We live a life of truth, right? It separates us. Notice the old identity in this passage you just shared with the old identity of the thief. They were labeled as such because of their actions. They're a thief. Why? Because they stole. Now in Christ, their new identity leads to what? Honest work. Honest being the key word here. It's real and it's true. A Christ follower has more value for their integrity and right standing with the Lord than with the amount of money they could potentially make or resources they could potentially steal. Honest labor flows from my identity in Christ, not from a place of trying to gain approval from Christ. While having a job is godly and honest labor pleases the Lord, it doesn't define my identity. Rather, it flows from who I am in Christ. No matter where I work, no matter what I do, you are experiencing Jesus. If I work at Chick-fil-A, you're meeting Jesus. If I work over, let me think of something else, McDonald's, right? You see Jesus. If I'm working at the Home Depot, you see Jesus, right? Everywhere I'm at, it doesn't matter where I'm working. It doesn't matter the job. If you encounter me on that job, you meet Jesus, because that's who I'm working for. That's everything I do is for his glory. So I do everything with all I have, with honesty, with truth, and with effort. Why? Because I'm working for the kingdom of God. Words matter, and how we speak is a reflection of what's in our hearts. Our words should edify those around us, not tear them down. I think pretty sure I shared this story before, but I had a really crazy awakening. We're about 2 years into our marriage or so. Maybe it was about three. And we did what most married couples do that love each other so much. We screamed at each other all the time. And just fought, you know. And we got one of those video doorbells, you know, those started getting popular. And one time we were having this argument, me sitting here screaming at each other, and we triggered the doorbell to start recording. Right, and so after we're done with our argument, which I think I won, by the way, but we won't keep score. No, I'm kidding. She won. Always wins. Okay, so I get a notification from my doorbell. It says you have a new recording. I was like, oh. I turn it on, and I hear myself screaming horrible things at her. And see, what out of the heart, the mouth speaks, I believe is what the Bible tells us. So it grieved not just me; it grieved the Holy Spirit when I heard it played back. Grieve me. And he immediately said, hey, you need to change. You need to talk different. Why? Because that was exposed of what's in your heart. You might not have really meant it fully, but it shows there's something in there and it needs to get dealt with. Right? And then, of course, I went and showed her part of the recording to her and said, pray about what the Spirit would have to speak to you about this. Right, but it's devastating, right? When you hear it, because it's the truth is coming out of what you really believe in certain situations, and that grieves the Spirit that you've allowed that to sit in your heart. Why? Because you let it land in your mind for too long. You didn't deal with it. Words matter. Here's a helpful thought. This is to see where you might be at. This is just a helpful little trick. If God gave you every word you had spoken over others, let's just say in the last 2 weeks, how would you be looking? If God answered everything, if everything you said, I hope happens to this person, he gave it to you, how would you be looking? Some of you might be like, well, I'm in danger, right? Like, this is bad, right? Exactly. It's a heart check. Thank God, by the grace of God, he does not. And thank God, he does what's called crop failure, right? Even the seeds you planted, he will kill them, right? Why? For the grace of you, right? Because he's protecting you. But here's the thing. Think about it. Our words matter. Jesus never spoke an idle word. Every word built up. Every word had promise to it. Every word was prophecy. He spoke it out. He built up those around him. He edified those around him. Words matter. Ephesians 4, 30-32, the last passage of Scripture, says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted. Now, this is a contrast from that callous heart. Remember that? We're to be tender-hearted. Forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. I don't know about y'all, but the longer I've walked with Jesus, my heart has. It's just become more tender. There's things that I see now, those military, like family reunited videos, those are the worst. Those will tear me up. I'm like, Cindy comes and she's like, what's wrong with you? I'm like, oh, nothing. I don't know. This is, oh, God. Like, I don't, why, my heart's become tender. Right? And I begin to, I do this crazy thing where I feel and I empathize with people and I start to want to see deeper than just what's on the surface. Why are you so angry? I want to know. I want you to be free from that. Not, you're a big jerk. Get out of my face. I never want to see you again. Right? Like, tenderhearted, not calloused, but tenderhearted. Stealing, coveting, sowing discord, lying, spreading false information, corruption, bitterness, wrath, the desire for revenge, slandering someone, anyone, gossip, all of these things grieve the Holy Spirit. I want you to think about this, because we feel really like at total liberty for whatever reason, that if it's a celebrity or if it's a politician or whatever it is, that we can just tear them down and remove the image of God off their life. I want you to realize they're still created in the image of God. Now, are they lying to you? Probably. Do they need to repent? Most likely, sure, yeah. But still, created in the image of God. You say, well, it doesn't matter if I lie about them because they're trash anyways. Think about what you just said. Think about what you just said. Maybe you didn't even say it, but you thought it. Tell the truth. Shame the devil. Be honest. Deal with those things that you're recognizing that do not align with the word of God. See, kindness is a defining characteristic of Christ followers, and it's mentioned again and again. We should be known by our kindness and how quick we are to forgive. The early Christians were being murdered. They were being put up on things. They were being hung up on like street lamps. They were being killed out in public. And the whole time they're being killed, they're praying, God, forgive them. Why? Because that's what they saw their Savior do. That's what I have to give you is forgiveness. That's what I have to give you is mercy. Does that mean we don't share the truth, don't stand up for what's right? No, absolutely not. Stand up. Be bold, but do it in kindness. It's really not at odds with each other. You can tell the truth and be kind. You can tell the truth in love. It's possible. We should be known for our kindness. This is the key in staying united. Be quick to repent and quick to forgive. Tell the truth. Shame the devil. Worship me if you guys will come help me out. Here's the thing. What do you need to be honest about today? What you been lying about? Let's just get real. Tell the truth. Shame the devil. See, here's the thing, too, is maybe we felt like we've been in an environment that's created a place where you can't be honest. And that shouldn't be the case. See, because we all got stuff. We're all dealing with things. We all have lied. And if you say, I've never lied, you're a liar. You're lying right now. Right? We need prayer. But I want to share something with you that I was up here praying yesterday, and I saw something that was really cool. But I've been listening to this song. It's been just nonstop on my mind. It's a New Elevation song, and basically the gist of the chorus is there's no waste at the altar. And this song has been just in my heart, talking about everything we bring to the altar. God uses it in ways that there is no shame. But what it requires is honesty. See, when you come to the altar, you got to be honest. Right? And I saw as I was praying, I was just welcoming the Lord. I said, Lord, just have your way tomorrow. Lord, I pray you work in people's hearts. And I begin to see, and just like this open vision in my mind, I begin to see Jesus literally walking down the aisles of this place. And all he was saying is, are you ready to tell the truth? Are you ready to tell the truth? Why? Because he's giving us an opportunity. Isn't it interesting that the first steps into the kingdom that we are to make, right, what's required is that we confess. Why? Because he's saying, start by speaking the language of the kingdom, the truth. What do we confess? We admit that we're a sinner. We confess that he is Lord, right? And then we receive him. But it starts with us being honest. Prayer partners, I want to invite you forward. See, when we respond to conviction honestly, nothing is wasted. So if you need prayer today, if you're struggling, whatever it is, maybe you're just angry, man. You're just angry. You've been angry. You got in a fight with your wife or your husband on the way here because you've just been mad. Why don't we deal with that today? Maybe you're in here and you've been living a lie. Can I tell you this is a safe place to be honest? To say, you know what, Pastor Matt, I've been playing. I haven't been legit. Right? This is a safe place to say that. And let me tell you, you're not going to meet shame when you bring this to the Lord. There's no shame at the altar. In fact, by being honest, by being truthful and saying, hey, I'm going to surrender this, you're actually shaming the devil. You're exposing his works. And you're saying, that's not me anymore. That we would tell the truth. Maybe you've had a lot of anger in your heart towards something or a certain person. Maybe you've been gossiping. You've been tearing people down left and right. And see, here's the thing. It's not exposing your rightness in a situation. It's exposing your insecurity. Why? Because you're lying. And you're spreading things. And you're dividing. So I want to invite you to repent of that. In fact, this is what I want to do. Let's do this. Let's start by this. Bow your heads all over this place. Let's start with this. Maybe you're in this place and you don't know Jesus. You don't have a relationship with him. And you heard the gospel today that Jesus Christ died on a cross for your sins. He rose again. He conquered death, hell, and the grave so you could be free. And it starts by you admitting that, one, you're a sinner in need of a Savior. And by confessing that he is Lord and believing in your heart that he did what he said he did. So if you're in this place, say, hey, I need to receive Jesus today. We just want to say a quick prayer with you. That's it. Just lift your hand really quickly. Say, hey, I need to receive Jesus today. Anybody in this room? Anybody online even? Let's pray this together really quickly. Jesus, I need you. I'm a sinner, and I'm in need of a Savior. Forgive me of my sins. I confess that you are Lord, that you are the Son of God, that you walked on this earth. You lived a perfect life, and you died my death. But you didn't stay dead. In 3 days, you rose again, and you conquered death, hell, and the grave, so I could be free. You are Lord. Holy Spirit, fill me up, equip me, empower me to live the life you've called me to live. Empower me to tell the truth, no matter what it costs, that I would be bold in you. And in Jesus' name. And everybody said. Now, very quickly, what I want to do is I'm going to pray over you guys. And if you would like prayer, I want you to come down, receive prayer. Right? If like when I was talking about Jesus walking around, asking if you're ready to tell the truth. If there's something you need to work through, don't leave this place in that state. Work through it. You say, well, you don't know, my marriage right now is a hot mess because of some of the things I've done and said. Okay, well, this is the best place to start, right here. I can tell you testimony after marriage, where they started at the altar, and that dumpster fire that they thought there's no way of repairing, it's been repaired, it's been restored, and it's better than it ever was. Why? Because it started with the truth. there's a problem, and I need Jesus. So I'm going to do this. I'm going to pray over all of you, and then I'm going to dismiss you. But if you'd like prayer, I want you to come forward. Please, come get prayer. We just want to pray with you. That's it. No shame. Nobody's going to assume that you're up there for this. Oh, they must be in. No. Listen, we all got problems, and we all need Jesus. So let's pray. Lord, I thank you for every person in this room. I pray if there's unforgiveness in our heart, we would let it go. Lord, forgive us if we've spread false information about someone. Lord, if we've slandered someone. Lord, if we've allowed our heart to be callous because of the thoughts, we've given authorization to land and stay. Lord, we repent of that. Forgive us. Lord, I pray for the one in here, though, that is struggling. Maybe nobody even knows. I pray that they would be bold today. They would accept your invitation. They would come forward. They would get prayer. And they wouldn't leave the same way. So, Lord, we trust you. We thank you that in this chaotic time, we can be at peace because we can know who we are in Christ. So we thank you. Lord, I pray we would learn from our anger. We wouldn't sin in our anger, but we would learn from it. We would process with you, and we would grow. We wouldn't be in the same place this time next year, but be closer to you. And we give you the praise, and we give you the glory. And in Jesus' name, everybody said. Now listen, if you'd like prayer, altar's open. If not, God bless you guys. You are dismissed. Just be respectful of those that may be up here praying. We love you. Hope to catch you next week.